What's good, y'all? It's your boy Ross back at again with another video. So we're gonna check out the incredibly rapid downfall of Ronda Rousey in WWE. Yeah, it I can't even really describe how when she came into WWE, the excitement, the I guess you can say the anticipation and the matches that she was having, and the general consensus from fans was, this was a good move. This is pretty cool. Ronda Rousey is in WWE. She's bringing that extra added, I guess you can say, spotlight and attention to the women's division. And at the time, you know, them really cultivating the women's revolution. Like, it was a good look. Then she ended up getting pregnant, and then when she came back for her second run, it was not the same. It's like, I don't know, it's hard to describe, but it didn't feel like she really had that same excitement, same love. I could be wrong, but it just felt like she was kind of going through the motions. So we definitely got to check this out by WrestleMania, man. That her rise and fall, especially in fans, like eyes and fans' perspective, it drastically changed. Like, it's crazy. And we still obviously know, you know, she's a respected combat sports individual. Everyone knows who Ronda Rousey is, but I don't know, it didn't land on her second go around in the company. So we're gonna check this out. Appreciate all the love and support.
It's sometimes been said, into this one. You can't go home again. If so, Ronda Rousey should have taken that advice, as her second run in WWE was every bit as bad as her first run was good. Join us now as we look at the dramatic downfall of Ronda Rousey in WWE.
Yeah.
Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell for daily wrestling videos, and follow us on Facebook for exclusive lists. Also, check out our new website, WrestleLamia.com.
Subscribe to WrestleLamia if you haven't already. That's some great wrestling-related content.
Ronda Rousey's road to the wrestling ring was full of twists and turns, much as her later WWE career would be. Rousey was a wrestling fan from childhood, watching the WWF alongside her sisters and even getting a Hulk Hogan wrestling buddy for her birthday. However, she would become a world-class judoka and MMA fighter before thoughts of wrestling became a reality. Nonetheless, pro wrestling was never far from her mind. For example, Rousey adopted the name Rowdy Ronda after meeting legendary wrestler Rowdy Roddy Piper and getting the Rowdy Scott's blessing to use it. Later, Rousey and her MMA friends Shayna Baszler, Marina Shafir, and Jasmine Duke dubbed themselves the Four Horsewomen of MMA, an homage to Jim Crockett Promotions' legendary Four Horsemen. When the Four Horsemen attended 2014 SummerSlam, fans began speculating whether they'd see one or more of the MMA stars jump to WWE.
Yeah.
With Rousey busy in UFC, this seemed uncertain. But that is until WrestleMania 31, where she joined The Rock in laying the smackdown on Triple H and Stephanie McMahon. Rousey's brief in-ring appearance had fans wondering whether Rousey would consider a match or even a career. In 2016, she worked her last UFC match, increasing the buzz she might actually join the WWE. After news broke in 2017 that the WWE had signed the baddest woman on the planet,
bro, the excitement, the buzz, I was like, okay, we got something here. This could be really, really good. We got something here, ladies and gentlemen.
Witness a grand debut rarely seen for a new WWE superstar. Rousey showed up at the 2018 Royal Rumble, with the WWE building a confrontation with her against Stephanie McMahon and Triple H. This led to a mixed tag match at WrestleMania 34 involving Ronda Rousey and Kurt Angle against Stephanie McMahon and Triple H, a high-profile match that reflected the massive build-up the WWE made with Rousey from the start. This was one of the WWE's biggest in-ring debuts in the company's history, and Rousey had the ability to bring in UFC fans as well as the general public. Could the WWE pull off Rousey's debut?
And that was arguably, I think a lot of people had said, that was the best match of that particular WrestleMania, because that particular WrestleMania was not, it was mid at best. But people, I fondly remember that match in particular, because she did her things. They stole the show. Ronda Rousey in her debut match was pretty damn good. For her first time really just being in a wrestling ring like that in front of thousands of people, like, she did really well. And that was arguably, in a lot of people's mind, the best match of the night. I enjoyed that match.
And make it special, though? Well, it turns out they very much could. the company, and more importantly, Rousey was praised for her debut match, which naturally she and Angle won. But things were only getting started as Rowdy Ronda received a Raw Women's Championship match against Nia Jax, losing after Alexa Bliss cashed in her Money in the Bank briefcase and won the title. The WWE's booking of Rousey showed it wasn't going to hotshot her to the top.
Mm-hmm.
Rousey was depicted as a formidable opponent, but the WWE also suggested Rousey was still learning the intricacies of wrestling, especially after she was kayfabe suspended for taking her frustrations out on WWE officials during a chase for Alexa Bliss's Raw Women's Championship. Her entry into the WWE only added to the excitement of a women's division that was enjoying a renaissance. Rowdy Ronda was making things better as she brought new media attention and viewers to the product. Some observers even felt she became the company's top star, female or otherwise. Whether this is true or not, Rousey's positive impact on the WWE and its women's division couldn't be denied.
Oh yeah, no, she was a very big integral of getting more eyes and more people to care about the women's division. Not to say that people didn't care already, but it was a good timing of really bringing her in and really expounding on the women's division as being that much more important than it's ever been. So she definitely deserves some kudos just off her name alone. It's Ronda Rousey wrestling on your TV on Monday Night Raw. That's an automatic like, oh shit, let me see what's going on here. What? Ronda Rousey's in WWE? Let me check it out.
Rousey's ring skills also couldn't be denied. Her sports experience in judo and MMA likely helped her adapt to professional wrestling, but as fans have seen many times, excellence in a sports is no guarantee of excellence in the ring.
Facts.
Athletes from other sports, including amateur wrestling, have reportedly noted how hard it is adapting to the intricacies of the ring.
Mm-hmm.
Despite some challenges, Rousey quickly adapted and had some entertaining matches that played to her strengths as a judoka and MMA fighter with a smattering of wrestling thrown in. But one area where Rousey heavily struggled was on the microphone.
Mm-hmm.
However, Rousey was still in her honeymoon period and the fans were willing to forgive any shortcomings on the promos and occasional slips in the ring.
And that's really what it was. People were loving the matches that she was having. People were they were excited to have Ronda Rousey on their television. So people forgave her on the not so great promos. Like, it's Ronda Rousey. So it's still like, damn, that's crazy. So people forgave her on that, you know, but her promos have always been okay to not okay. I wouldn't say they were awful, but they were just like, eh, you know, it didn't. You're more excited because it's who she is than what she's saying, if that makes any sense.
After squashing Alexa Bliss for the Raw Women's Championship at SummerSlam, Rousey had some solid championship defenses against challengers such as Alexa Bliss, Sasha Banks, and Natalya.
Mm-hmm.
While all three women had shown they could carry just about any opponent, Rousey was no broom in need of being elevated to a watchable match. Unfortunately, wrestling fans can be fickle.
By
Survivor Series, there were signs the honeymoon was over for Ronda Rousey. This was made clear when the WWE decided to turn Becky Lynch heel, an unpopular decision made even worse when the WWE eventually paired Rousey against Lynch.
Mm-hmm.
They shouldn't have been surprised when fans cheered Becky and booed Rousey, but then again, this was when Vince McMahon was running things and he was often blind to what was obvious to everyone else.
Yep.
One person who was surprised was Ronda Rousey.
Yep.
Who was still learning.
And one of those, once Becky got over, there was not even Ronda could really counteract that. It was Becky was too over. It was that simple. I believe the situation, Becky was supposed to have a match with Ronda, but she couldn't because of an injury. So Charlotte was in her place and Charlotte brutally attacks her. And I'm guessing that spot was supposed to be Becky, but Charlotte ended up getting cheered. So it's just one of those things where the fans had turned because they cared more about Becky. And that's the crazy thing about wrestling fans, you know, like if we want someone in a particular situation and we care about them, even though we've gotten someone like a Ronda Rousey now on our television, we're like, oh, that's cool. But Becky, she's been here and she's now gotten super over. We want her. We care about her. Ronda, you cool, but we care about her. That's how it can be with wrestling fans.
How fickle the WWE universe could be. Fans would learn in subsequent interviews just how much this treatment angered Rousey, and in turn leading to some nasty comments from her.
Yep.
Despite this setback, Rousey's first run in WWE continued to be entertaining.
For sure.
Especially when she feuded with Becky Lynch in a program where both women pulled no punches in their efforts to get at
this
each other
with
the
good.
Ring or backstage.
This was good.
WrestleMania 35 featured the first ever main event featuring women, with Becky Lynch battling Raw Women's Champion Ronda Rousey and SmackDown Women's Champion Charlotte Flair in a triple threat winner-takes-all match. Although some fans were disappointed that WWE felt the need to add Flair to the match,
yeah.
The bout was well received overall and ended in controversy as Lynch covered Rousey for a three count, but the referee didn't see Rousey had raised her shoulder before the three count.
Mm-hmm.
This left things open for a rematch. Rousey's exit from the WWE after WrestleMania 35 went as planned. Her first run was an overall success, bringing new attention to the women's division and helping to elevate Becky Lynch into a main event star. However, would Rousey return? But for the time being, the answer seemed no, as Rousey hinted at starting a family,
mm-hmm.
but then the pandemic hit and any return seemed to go on hold. Meanwhile, Rousey began blasting the fans for the way she'd been treated in the company when they turned on her. In addition, she began criticizing the fake fighting in the WWE, a silly statement since she'd happily signed a deal there. And
yeah,
had been...
she started. Then that's when it got bad. And I think people kind of like... looked at her differently, because here's the thing, and I get it, fans, they are fickle, but at the same time, it's part of the business, and if you're not who the fans really want to see anymore, they want to see somebody else, that's just what it is. If anything, you play into it, but I think she kind of took it personally, because they were, bro, fans were shitting on her. That Survivor Series match, oh, bro, they were booing her, and they were glad that that happened to her, that she got beaten up, and I think she should have played into it. But here, this is where things got a little dicey for her, because then it's like, well, you shouldn't on the business that you signed up to be in, that you grew up watching. Like, where is this coming from? Like, that's very interesting that you would say that.
Been a wrestling fan since she was a child.
Yeah.
As Rousey's statements became more venomous, fans doubted whether she'd ever return. In some cases, fans didn't even care.
Yeah.
But it's worth mentioning that Rousey had always been known for stirring the pot, whether it was in UFC or the WWE. In fact, prior to WrestleMania 35, Rousey referred to wrestling as scripted, a move which some saw as evidence Rousey was disrespectful towards wrestling, while others saw Ronda being, well, just Ronda. Regardless of Rousey's comments, the WWE were happy to bring her back at the 2022 Royal Rumble.
Yeah.
Her return popped the audience, but for some fans, it was clear from the moment Ronda entered the arena that this return was very different. Rousey was talked up by the announcers as a babyface, but the look on her face suggested otherwise as she oscillated between disgust and amusement. Imagine taking everything that worked during a successful run and doing everything you can to ignore what made the first run so successful.
Mm-hmm.
Not only that, but find new ways to hamper a wrestler's career.
Mm-hmm.
For many fans, this is what the WWE did with Rousey in 2022. As mentioned, Ronda Rousey...
I mean, her coming back, you knew she was going to win. It was like, all right, well, here we go. You know what I'm saying? If they would have really ramped up her heel persona, I think that would have been much better than what we ended up getting. Because I believe at one point she was still trying to be this babyface, but no one cared. No one actually cared. And I think they really should have hampered down or doubled down on just her being a heel. Just a heel that feels like she's better than everybody else. She's better than the business. They need her. WWE needs her. Do that. Play into that. Not playing into this person that said all these things on social media. Now, hey guys, I'm back. You remember me? You love me? You remember me?
She didn't do herself any favors when she trash-talked wrestling and WWE fans during her hiatus from the company.
Yeah.
Bringing her back as a babyface was very unwise. Things might have worked better if Rousey came back, doubling down on the WWE universe for betraying her by booing her. This would have been believable and spared Rousey from playing a babyface role she was clearly uncomfortable with.
Yes.
Rousey's Royal Rumble win opened the door for a huge WrestleMania rematch, since Becky Lynch was working as a heel and a rematch seemed like the only logical choice.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you're, of course, Vince McMahon, who booked Rousey against Charlotte Flair instead at WrestleMania. The Mania match featured an anticlimactic finish with Flair scoring a controversial win after a convenient ref bump kept the official from seeing Flair tap out to Rousey's armbar. As Rousey checked on the referee, Flair hit a big boot, scoring a quick pin. What could have been an exciting match turned into one that left nobody happy. Mm-hmm. Rousey fans couldn't believe the finish, while critics of the Queen noted it's another example of the WWE's preferential treatment towards Flair. The match also showed that WWE hadn't found a way to deal with its biggest problem with Rousey, her status as an unstoppable opponent.
Mm-hmm.
One of the biggest criticisms of Ronda Rousey is that the WWE booked her as unbeatable, which effectively destroyed any suspense in the matches. In real life, it's unlikely any female on the roster could defeat Rousey in the ring. Perhaps that's why WWE booked her as unbeatable, feeling no one would believe her dropping a match without interference or a bad call by the referee. However, wrestling fans like to see a competitive match or one that tells a story of a plucky underdog stopping a seemingly invincible.
I mean, we've seen it with fucking Brock Lesnar and Daniel Bryan. That was a great match. I believe that was at Survivor Series. And Daniel Bryan was a heel at that time. And he made that match somewhat believable. We know Daniel Bryan is a wrestling technician. We know that. And they made it believable that maybe Danielson could pull off an upset. Now, granted, of course, he had to kick him and, you know, hit him with a low blow. So that too. But at the same time, he still, you know, Danielson is dangerous when it comes to his submissions and his technical prowess when it comes to, you know, stopping his opponent in the middle of that ring. So they were able to make that believable and entertaining. You know, once again, they gave Brock an out because he's a heel at this time. But even if I think the reports was before Danielson got injured the first go around when he won the championship at WrestleMania 30, the plan was for him to drop it, I believe, to Brock Lesnar that SummerSlam. And he would have been a babyface, the overwhelming underdog babyface. But I think that was supposed to be when he dropped the title to Brock Lesnar at SummerSlam. And then that's when they inserted John Cena into the mix. But the fact is, I'm willing to bet that match would have been a little bit similar, except it wouldn't have been a situation where Danielson would have cheated. It would have been just a situation that Brock just would have, you know, taken care of business. But yeah, there's ways to do it without it being, you know, you can buy into it.
Opponent. As fans have seen with monsters like Brock Lesnar, a monster heel can run roughshod, but can also show vulnerability and eventually lose, elevating an opponent.
Just said it.
For Ronda Rousey to be a long-term asset, the WWE had to come up with a way to keep her strong without her being portrayed as invincible. They didn't, and even worse, the WWE followed up with a Flair vs. Rousey program with a Liv Morgan vs. Ronda Rousey program. Morgan had never been portrayed as main event wrestler.
No.
While fans have always admired her guts, she's one of the last wrestlers who seemed like a threat to Rousey.
Yeah.
The WWE pulled off a title switch thanks to the ever helpful Money in the Bank briefcase.
Yeah.
For fans knew Morgan's days as champion were limited.
Yeah, I was like, I was happy for her, but come on, bro. Come on, bro. No one bought into this match. You only bought into this match because you're a fan of her. Come on, bro. Liv Morgan has never looked intimidating. Attractive, sure. A little bit deranged and crazy, maybe. But intimidating? No. Even in her mugshot recently, she didn't look intimidating. So you expect us to believe that Ronda Rousey is supposed to be intimidated by Liv Morgan? We're supposed to buy into that. As soon as they did that, I knew. I was like, oh, this is GG's, bro. This is not, it's not working out.
They somehow extended Rousey's quest to regain the match into two more matches with another bad referee call giving Morgan the win. An Extreme Rules match created the illusion Morgan might defeat Rousey, particularly if she used a front loader as Brock Lesnar had done against Roman Reigns at SummerSlam, but thankfully the WWE ended things there, giving fans hope the WWE would find stronger opponents. Instead, the WWE threw one hapless opponent after another at Rousey, taking things to ridiculous levels as Rousey teamed up with a pal Shayna Baszler to beat up and bully the women's undercard like sixth graders terrorizing second graders. The attacks served no storyline purpose and devalued the women's undercard as no one rose up to the challenge. Although Raquel Rodriguez could have been elevated through her program with Rousey, the WWE had Rousey and Baszler destroy Raquel's arm, making her subsequent title match another one with a foregone conclusion.
Yep.
By this point, it appeared the WWE saw just how much damage Rousey was doing to its women's division. So it had a returning Charlotte Flair beat Rousey in an impromptu match after Ronda polished off Rodriguez. But did the WWE think it was better that Rousey enter the tag team division and destroy it rather than the singles division? It's unknown what the reason for Rousey's move to the tag division was, because Rousey gave multiple reasons for not working tag matches. Initially, she said it was always her goal to compete in the tag division with a real-life BFF Shayna Baszler and win the women's tag titles. Later, she added that she and Baszler wanted to elevate the tag titles, which, to be fair, had been a hot mess since Sasha Banks and Naomi walked out of the WWE with them. But then an arm injury put Rousey's tag team championship ambitions on hold, but once she came back, she and Baszler won the belts, promising a long reign. The WWE pushed this idea with Rousey and Baszler defending the NXT Women's Tag Team Champions Alba Fire and Ilha Dawn to unify the titles.
Yep.
However, the title reign was short-lived, as Baszler shockingly turned on Rousey during their title defense
against
Raquel Rodriguez at Money in the Bank, leading to a SummerSlam match between Rousey and Baszler. A rumor has it that Rousey wanted to put over Baszler by giving her a strong win. And while the match wasn't a squash, Baszler dominated Rousey, getting the win as Rousey exited the WWE once again.
And this could have been so much better if there was some proper build to it, but I don't know about her contract situation, so it was kind of like, we got to get this over quickly. I think this should have definitely been a better build, because people have been wanting to see something like this. But all of a sudden, she just turned on her, and then it was like, oh, okay. And some of the promos and stuff and packages leading up to it was good. I was here for it. But when that match happened, no one cared. Absolutely no one. And I wanted to care, but no one cared. There were people that was at that show that said, bro, people were just going to the concession stands. I was there. I was one of the people that was going to the concession stands. That should let you know. Jeez, man, that sucked.
I don't know just what the WWE's program with Rousey and Baszler was all about. The two teamed for what was believed to be a run that would elevate the women's tag titles, but instead it quickly led to breakup and a poorly received feud. Since then, Baszler has been an afterthought she was before teaming with Rousey. Now, Rousey's second run was a complete dud. The WWE deserves blame for its bad booking, not only for its choice in Rousey's opponents, but in failing to create any suspense with her matches. But Ronda deserves blame too. A bad attitude and laziness in the ring strongly suggests her second run was all about a quick paycheck. Her second run showed no improvement in the ring or on the microphone.
Nope.
Actually, Rousey's in-ring work and mic work even declined.
Yep.
What had began as one of the best wrestling debuts in WWE history rapidly turned into an underwhelming and lazy return.
Yep.
Do you agree? Let us know in the comments down below. I'll see you next time with some more wrestling content.
Yeah, man. Her downfall was... She takes blame in it. She definitely does take blame in it. This is... That shit was not that good, bro. For a caliber talent of Ronda Rousey, world-renowned athlete, you would expect a little bit better. That was not it. And to be honest with you, I know she's doing, you know, her little wrestling thing, you know. I wouldn't say little, because obviously she still cares about, you know, wrestling. But I know she's doing it in other promotions and stuff on her own terms. Cool. I don't think she needs to go to AEW legitimately. No. And I don't think she needs to come back either. I think she does what she does on the independent circuits, whatever makes her feel happy, however she want to do it, and leave it at that. Because, well, granted, I don't know. I don't think she needs to come back. Even with Triple H being in control, I'm sure it probably would be a little bit better. But, nah, I don't know. And granted, I can't, you know, you never know. Never say never. We've seen some surprising things, so maybe that does happen maybe one day. I don't know, but it shouldn't be anytime soon. I'm gonna leave it at that. This her second run just it did not land at all. So comment down below. Let me know. How do you guys feel about Ronda Rousey's complete run in WWE? Do you guys agree her first run was better than her second run? Or did some of you guys enjoy her second run better than her first run? I'm sure there's somebody out there that enjoyed when she came back. Let me know how you felt about her entire run in whole in WWE. But I appreciate all the love and support you guys shown on channel Road to 150K. And I'm still young, speed the YouTube rest and champ of the world. Appreciate y'all kicking in with me. See you on the next one. Peace.